The Lord be with you. Good morning and welcome to our service this morning. Welcome to those of you who are watching on YouTube and also to those of you on the telephone. Good morning. Okay, we'll assume they're there. Good morning on the phone.
Nice. We're here.
Good morning.
We're all here.
We can't hear you very well though, Phil.
Okay, I'll move this microphone closer to me, see if that helps. Okay.
Is that a bit better?
Is that any better?
A little bit. Not a lot, but a little bit.
Okay. I shall try and enunciate properly.
Yeah, do.
Okay.
That's terribly good.
Good.
Fine.
Super. So, if you haven't worked it out already, this is a service of worship, but it is also the APCM. So that's our annual church meeting. We wouldn't normally combine the two in one big thing altogether. However, the COVID restrictions say that we are able to meet for worship, but we're not able to meet for meetings. So the alternative would be for you to all to come and join us in worship and then to all go home again and dial in and meet with us exactly the same people. So we've checked and the rules say that we are allowed to have this meeting if we do it within the context of worship. So we've got a few extra bits of business that we'll need to get through this morning. I'm not going to be leading the service. Tracy's going to lead the service, but I will chair the meetings. And in fact, there's an added complication here because you may not have noticed in previous years, but technically there are two meetings that we need to do. There is the annual meeting of parishioners to elect church wardens, which has an electorate which includes all the residents of the parish of Wroughton and Wichelstowe, whether or not they are church members or church attenders. And then there's a second meeting, which is our APCM, which is our annual parochial church meeting, for which the electorate are you guys, so members of the electoral roll of this church. So we're going to, in order to split the business up so it doesn't feel like we've got a whole block of kind of admin-y type stuff tacked on the end of our worship, we're going to do the first meeting first, the election of church wardens, and then we'll do the APCM at the end. Okay? So I'll come to that in a minute, but before I do, I just want to draw your attention to the notice sheet. So if you're on email, then hopefully you will have already received this. If you are not on email, then there are copies at the back of church. And on the back of it, there is a reading plan. The reading plan is for the book that we are following for our sermon series on prayer. It happens to have been chosen for the National Big Church Read. So sometimes coincidences happen and sometimes it's God. So maybe God is suggesting that you might like to read this book. I'll leave that to you and him. The Big Church Read. I also need to very sadly say that another member of our congregation died during the week. So if you didn't hear the news already, then Anne Richards passed away this week. So please do pray for Anne's family and, of course, for David Evans's family. David died the week before as they learn how to live without somebody who they loved very much. So please do hold them in your prayers this week. Good. So we will do the annual meeting for the election of church wardens. But before we do that, I need to find out who we've got. So everybody in the church building has signed in, I hope. People on the YouTube, I'm afraid you're not going to be able to vote because our technology doesn't, our use of technology rather, doesn't stretch that far. However, the facility for people who are not in the church building who would like to be able to vote is on the telephone. So If you would like to speak and to input into the meeting, then you'll need to dial in to the telephone meeting. So that we know who's on the phone, I'm going to need to do a bit of a roll call. So if you could unmute the phone. And I've heard Barbara, so that's one. Other people on the phone, would you like to just say your names so that we capture you? Margaret Parsons.
Margaret Parsons.
Thank you, Margaret.
Hilary Dunn Parsons, yes.
Hi, Hilary.
Pat Herring.
Hello, Pat.
Hi. Gordon Barclay.
Oh, didn't quite catch that one, sorry.
Gordon Barclay.
Gordon. Gordon?
Yes.
Yeah. Hello. Okay. Anybody else?
Rosina Stephen.
Rosina. Hello, Rosina.
Morning.
John and Iris Smith.
John and Iris Smith. Hello, John and Iris.
Paul Godfrey.
Hello, John.
Sheila Tubby.
Hello, Sheila.
Karen Harrison.
Hello, Karen.
Anna Godwin.
Hello, Anna.
Hello.
Stuart Eager.
Hello, Stuart. Good morning.
Good morning, Sylvia.
Oh, that was a bit quiet. Sorry.
Good morning, Sylvia.
Sylvia, was that?
Sylvia. Hello, Sylvia.
Good morning.
Good morning. Okay, any others? Good, okay, so all of those people are present at the meeting and all of the people in the building are present at the meeting. So our first item of business then is to receive and approve the minutes of the last annual meeting of parishioners, which was held on the 11th of October 2020. You'll remember that because of COVID, our annual meetings didn't happen until very late in the year. So we actually held this meeting in October last time round. The minutes of the last meeting were very simple. It just said we elected two church wardens and they were Helena and Mike. So are we happy to receive those minutes as an accurate record? Yeah.
Yep.
Thank you very much. Our next item of business, final item of business for this particular bit of the meeting, is to elect two church wardens. Now, I've received two nomination papers. They are from Mike Orr and also from Peter Ferguson. And because they are unopposed, they are duly elected as our church wardens for 2021. Thank you very much. Which means, of course, that Helena, our long-standing church warden, is retiring. So I wonder now if I could invite Helena, first of all, and Mike Orr, perhaps, to come up to the front, because we'd like to make a fuss of Helena and thank her very much. Am I on?
Yes.
We have to be sort of socially distanced and things, so this is a bit awkward, but there we go. Some flowers, some fizz, and a card. Should we give Helen a big clap? We're going to pray for Helena in a moment, but I just wanted to publicly say a huge thank you to you for everything that you've done. You and Mike really have been the dream team for me arriving in Wroughton and trying to work out what's what and who's who and how everything works, and just the way that you've got on with stuff and sorted stuff out and allowed me not to worry about them. Just great, and I'm going to miss you a lot. So thank you very much for all that you've done.
Thank you. Well,
It did take me out of my comfort zone at times, but it's good to be challenged, isn't it, by God. So, but thank you for the support and encouragement of everyone, all the team at the church. And it's been a pleasure to serve you all. So thank you.
Can I just add, as the other church warden, working with Helena for the last quite a few years, I don't know if any of you find, sometimes when there's a job to be done, it's not the sort of job you'd like, you tend to leave it, and then you leave it, and you leave it. But whenever there was a job I didn't like, if I mentioned it to Helena, Helena would immediately pick it up with her usual efficiency, her encouragement, and basically get things moving. So, Helena, thank you very much for all that you've done. It's been great working with you as a church warden, and you deserve your retirement from being a church warden.
But she's not going very far away, so.
No.
So I wonder if we could just pray for Helena now. So Lord God, we thank you for Helena. We thank you for all that she is, all that she has to offer, all that she has to give. We thank you for the way that you have led and directed her in her life, for the strength that you've given her, for the gifts that you've given her. And we pray that she will continue to hear from you, that she will continue to be led by you as she perhaps steps into something new or different. And we give you thanks above all. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
Great. Mike, you're not allowed to go away yet. Now, we've elected a new church warden, so Pete, do you want to come and... So he looks like this. And things that you might have said to Helena, you can now say to Pete. Thank you, Pete, for being willing to stand again. I'm just hugely grateful, and thank you for your support over the last couple of years, and thank you in anticipation for your support over the year to come. We should pray for and commission both of these good people for the ministry that they have for the year ahead. I would kind of like to do this, not just me praying, but I realise it's a bit awkward with distancing and things. So if you have a prayer that you'd like to say, just say it loud and clear from where you're sitting. Other years, I'd like to kind of invite you to gather around, but we can't quite do that at the moment. But let's pray for these two guys. So we thank you, Lord, for Mike and for Pete. We thank you for their gifts, for their abilities. We thank you for their love for you, for their relationship with you, for their wisdom. Lord, would you give them wisdom? Would you help them to discern what is your will for this congregation, for this church of people over the 12 months ahead? Come, Holy Spirit, fill them, commission them now. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Great, thank you. Thanks,
Pete. Good, so that concludes the annual meeting of parishioners, and we will now move to our order of service. So, Tracy.
Good morning. Let us pray. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. As we prepare to celebrate the mystery of God's love revealed in word and sacrament, let us call to mind our sins. And we say together, most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen.
May God our Father give you your sins, bring you to the fellowship of his table with the saints forever.
Amen. Amen. And our responsory. Death is swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your sting? Christ is risen from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. Death is swallowed up in victory. The trumpet will sound and the dead shall be raised. Where, O death, is your sting? We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed. Death is swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your sting? Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Alleluia. Risen, ascended Lord, as we rejoice at your triumph, fill your church on earth with power and compassion, that all who are estranged by sin may find forgiveness and know your peace. To the glory of God the Father. Amen. Amen. And now we're going to have our reading by Lillian.
The reading is taken from Exodus chapter 32, starting at verse 7. The Lord said to Moses, go down at once, your people, whom you brought out of the land of Egypt, have acted perversely. They have been quick to turn aside from the ways that I have commanded them. They have cast for themselves an image of a calf and have worshipped it and sacrificed to it, and said, these are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt. The Lord said to Moses, I have seen these people, how stiff-necked they are. Now let me alone, so that my wrath and my burning hot against them, and I may consume them, and of you I will make a great nation. But Moses implored the Lord his God and said, O Lord, why does your wrath burn against your people, whom you brought up out of the land of Egypt, with great power and with a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say, it was with evil intent that he brought them out to kill them in the mountains and to consume them from the face of the earth? Turn away from your fierce wrath, change your mind, and do not bring disaster on our people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, your servants, how you swore to them by your own self, saying to them, I will multiply your descendants like the stars of heaven, and all this land that I have promised I will give to your descendants, and they shall inherit it forever. And the Lord changed his mind about the disasters that he had planned to bring on his people. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Father, help us to pray aright, that we might live aright. Amen. Excuse me. This morning is the fourth in our sermon series on prayer, based around the book How to Pray by Pete Gregg and featured in our 2021 Lent course. In week one, Phil looked at why pray. Week two, Martina looked at adoration in prayer, with Phil looking at petition last week. Petition meaning to pray for ourselves. And excuse my voice, it seems to have gone a bit. Today, my topic is intercession, asking for others. In 3 weeks' time, Tracy will be looking at the subject of unanswered prayer. I'm glad I'm not Tracy. All I will say is that prayer is never unanswered. It is just that sometimes the answer is not yet or no to how you want, but answered in a totally different way. I look forward to her wisdom on the subject. And that's my prayer answered, thank you. Intercession is the act of saying a prayer on behalf of another, which, if we are honest, is basic Christian caring. In everyday life, we might plead on behalf of a work colleague in trouble with their manager, or try and arbitrate between two parties or two friends. Intercessionary prayer is no different. We are doing exactly that, but with God. We are intervening on behalf of another. We are exercising our relationship with our Lord, not ignoring him, but talking to him. Phil said that prayer is going to the top, which it is. Yet Catholics also pray to Mary, the mother of Jesus. Despite allegations to the contrary, they do not see her as a god herself. They are asking her to amplify, to boost their request, to pray for us, to intercede for us, much in the same way that we might ask each other to pray for us. People have different views on this, as I'm sure there probably are within this congregation. But whatever they are, it is still important that people pray together, which Pete Gregg calls getting into sync with each other. Yes, God hears one or two, but is even more impressed when we are in agreement with each other. There is a unique power invested in the united intercession of God's people. Some might feel uneasy about asking God to intervene on behalf of others. What right do they have to question him? Intercession is not challenging God. It is a dialogue, an important part of our relationship with him. We have free will, and we can use our free will to restrict or to release the power of God. If we were to just blindly follow, we would not be how God wants us to be. We follow because we know it to be right, not because we are told to. According to Pete Gregg, God has delegated his power to our free will, so prayer is very significant. Ask and you shall receive. Seek and you will find. In our reading from Exodus 32, we see how important it is to intercede. The people were lost. They were fed up, and with their expectations frustrated, were turning away from God. They created new idols in the hope that these gods might deliver them. Rather like we might do if in physical need one neighbour refuses to help, so we will go and pester another. God was understandably angry. We tend to forget this side of God, instead preferring the warm, comfy feel of his embracing love, which he has for us. Even in secular society, we have lost the concept of responsibilities and of the consequences of not fulfilling them. Everywhere the buzzword is my rights, not my duty. Moses knew that even in his anger, God still cared. Moses intercedes, laying out the case why the people should be spared for their disobedience. After all, there were serious consequences of ignoring the instruction, "You shall have no God but me. I am the one true God." God listens, and his love, not his anger, prevails. The people are spared, albeit punished in other ways instead. The same love that sent God's Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, to die on the cross to spare us from the consequences of our sin. Moses had the right relationship with God and could speak with respectful confidence. He demonstrated what Pete Gregg calls getting indignant. When we intercede, we need to be passionate, not half-hearted. Don't just say the words, going through the motions, as it were, but mean it. Interceding is caring for another. Show that you care. Be enthusiastic about what you are asking. In order to be enthusiastic, you need to know what you are asking for and evaluate if it is really the right thing to be asking for. Often the answer to prayer appears to be no, because it is not what is right or in the best long-term interest, as Tracy, I'm sure, will be exploring. If you can find out as much information as is available, so you can then better target your request. Moses was informed and so knew how to express himself in a way that God listened. Alongside getting informed is also getting inspired. Be open to hearing God. What does he want you to pray for? Sometimes we get the urge to pray for someone or something without knowing why. Don't ignore it, be inspired by it. Remember, there is a unique power invested in the united intercession of God's people. Our prayer, when added to others whom we may not even know are praying, can make all the difference. Maybe it is just a simple case of being excited about the possibilities about what could happen if God's purposes for a particular person, place, or situation actually started to come true. Life is complicated, our Christian living even more so. God has promised that if my people will pray and humble themselves, then he, that's God, will heal their land. This is really what we are asking for when we say, "Thy kingdom come," in the Lord's Prayer. Prayer is not God saying amen to what I want, but saying amen to what God wants. Using our free will to amplify, not diminish, God's power and love. Still unsure how to intercede? Don't worry. Just relax and respectfully talk to God. It really is that simple. Just relax and respectfully talk to God. Pete Gregg's model, which I have covered, put into the order of the book, is a useful how-to tool. Get informed. Get inspired. What is God saying? Get indignant. Mean it. And get in sync with the power and unity of others. Live it, believe it, and pray it. And may we all do so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you for that. And thank you, Mark, for the challenge for 3 weeks' time. So, let us affirm our faith in Jesus Christ, the Son of God. So please stand if you're able. And we say together, though he was divine, he did not cling to equality with God, but made himself nothing. Taking the form of a slave, he was born in human likeness. He humbled himself and was obedient to death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God has raised him on high and given him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow and every voice proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord. To the glory of God the Father. Amen. Please sit or kneel for our prayers.
Let us pray. Lord, we pray for your church, which day by day gathers to praise you and hear your holy word. We pray for our Christian brothers and sisters worshipping around the world in all places, rural and town churches, great city cathedrals, and on the internet or phone. We ask for your protection for all those persecuted as a result of their Christian faith. We pray for our church, for our clergy and lay ministers, whose preaching and teaching inspires us with the message of your salvation. We pray for our annual meeting this morning, and for our PCC and church wardens, and give thanks for their willingness to help in the running and organization of this church. Help each one of us to listen to your voice and find the part that we can play in sharing your good news in the way that we live. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for countries where there is war, random violence, or only fragile peace. Give to those who are trying to make peace an inner certainty of their calling and constant patience in their negotiations. May hearts which have been darkened by violence discover a new light, and may the ways of diplomacy and forgiveness coincide at the conference table. We give thanks for the vaccination program here in UK and for the lifting of further restrictions next week. Help all countries to work together to enable the weakest and poorest communities to get vaccinated, and be with those places, and especially India, where the COVID virus is still raging. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we thank you for all those who help our local community to run smoothly because of their jobs, voluntary work, or neighborliness. We pray for the spiritual health of our communities, that our church may be a spiritual family, a household of faith where people are welcomed and nourished. We pray for our social community, that you would make it a place where all can flourish and the weak be cared for, where there is harmony and true civic pride. We give thanks for local councillors, MPs, mayors and police commissioners, that you will give them wisdom and compassion, and that their leadership be that of the servant, and their goals that of heaven. And we give thanks for the life and service of Anne Richards, local councillor, active church member, and guider, who died this week. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. The heart of the instinct to pray for those in need is the instinct to love. We pray for those who are going through times of trouble, some perhaps in our families, some in our church, some in our wider circle of friends. We know you to be both Lord and healer of your broken world, and we ask you to touch with your love all those who are in our hearts today because of their special need. And in a moment of silence, we lift them to you. May your love flood their lives with hope and healing of spirit, mind, and body. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Finally, Lord, we bring before you those who've died recently or at this time of year. Give to the departed the perfect joy of your eternal love, and to those bereaved by their passing, the consolation of your perfect love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy Lord, send us out into the world today, mindful that as witnesses and servants, we should make you known in every place we visit and bear witness to the gospel with acts of faith and hope and love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Rejoicing in God's new creation, let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Good. So we come now to our second meeting, which is the APCM proper. There is an agenda and various papers on a little shelf at the back. If you didn't pick one of those up on the way in and you'd like to follow what's going on, then now's your opportunity to leap up and grab copies of those things whilst we organise ourselves at the front. Right. Great. I shall assume that everybody is happy, or happy as can be. Lovely. So we begin our annual parochial church meeting, and the first item is to receive apologies. So I've received apologies from Linda Pell and Mike Mason. Does anybody know of any other apologies? No? Okay. Thank you for that. Second item is to receive the minutes of the last APCM. So there is a copy of the minutes at the back of church, and they were emailed out to those of you on email. Are we happy that they are a true reflection of the last meeting, which was held in October? Yeah, happy. And I need to ask the phone as well, are you happy?
I can't hear them.
Are you happy? Are you happy with the
minutes?
I'm
unmuted. I don't know if people are unmuted properly. Hang on.
What's the date? Okay. I've actually picked up a pink pen. I don't know why I've got a pink pen. I don't suppose it's less legal, is it, if I've got a pink pen? Okay, were there any matters arising from the minutes of the last meeting which are not already on the agenda of this meeting that people would like to raise? Nobody in the room? No. Anybody on the phone got anything you'd like to raise, matters arising? Okay, I'll take silence as a no. Okay, so item four is to receive a report on the changes to the electoral roll since the last APCM. So I can tell you that the electoral roll last year was 170, and this year we have 164 members on the electoral roll. I think we just received that, so that's information. Okay. Done. And now we need to receive the annual report. So at the back of church, there were three things. There was the annual report and financial statements. There was also a report on church life, another little booklet, and then there was, or is rather, a treasurer's report, which is a sheet of A4. So we're talking about the annual report and financial statements of the parochial church council. So are we happy to receive the annual report? Yes. Yes, okay. On the phone, are we happy to receive the annual report?
Yes.
Yep. Thank you, Barbara.
I don't know. I can't hear anybody else, so I'm presuming there's still some people here. I should check numbers.
I'm sure they'll speak if they're not.
They will. Oh, I think the bloop means someone just left, isn't it? Oh, well.
There are only seven people here, Mike.
Fine. Okay, well,
shout if you want to interject, because we can't see you, obviously. So if you need to say something, then do say it. Don't.
I'm going to mute them and unmute them again, just to make sure that they're unmuted. Okay.
Okay. All right. I'll carry on. So we've done 5.1, which was to receive the annual report. And the proceedings of the PCC, which is inside the annual report. Is that it, is it?
Yeah, that's the 5.1.
Okay. Ah, and the activity, which is that.
Yeah.
Okay. Are we happy to receive the other one, the report on church life as well?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
Great. Sure. Thank you. Okay, so 5.2 is the financial statements of the Parochial Church Council for the year ending, which is, yeah, okay, that's included in the annual report on church life.
And explained by Nick's
helpful report, which is this thing. Okay, so very helpful. Yes, I agree, actually. Yeah, so let's take a little moment to think about the Treasurer's report, just because I hope you'll find that the explainer that Nick has provided is a really good guide. So I'm going to assume that people have read it before the meeting. Maybe that's a wrong assumption. But does anybody have any questions that they'd like to ask or points that they'd like to raise reflecting on the finances? Because we do have Nick with us, so he can answer questions. Yes, Lillian.
It may be that I haven't read the report properly, but I'm interested in what it has cost us to put on the phone thing and the camera thing. You know, the just out of interest, mm-hmm. not because I'm criticising, I think it's absolutely fantastic. I'm just interested in how much that all cost.
Yep, good question. So the question was, how much did it cost us this year to put on the phone service and to install the camera, which I'm looking at? The I can tell you, because I paid for the phone thing, or I organised the phone thing rather, that whilst we had lots of people on the phone, so more than, or whilst there was, we did have more than 50, actually. Well, whilst we had more than 50 people on the phone, it cost us £34 a month to pay for that facility. Now that we have less people on the phone, it's costing us £4 a month for the phone thing, which is not a lot of money, which is good. The camera was a bit more than that. and I didn't organise it. So, Nick, are you able to chuck out a figure, or do we need to take it away? Yep.
The changes to the service will accommodate the camera and the camera itself are about £6,000.
So there were some changes that were that we needed to make to the sound desk anyhow. So it's a little bit more complicated than that, because it's not just paid for the camera, but the sound desk is fairly old and needed some changes doing to it. So yeah, but we've spent that. Yes, Tracy.
I was just going to say, to bear in mind that because we now can stream services, people will be paying for streaming of weddings, or so we will also be getting an income from
the question was definitely not a criticism.
It's good,
just a matter
of
interest, because I don't know how much these things cost, and I can't see it itemized. That was all. It's not a criticism. I think it's a wonderful service.
Anybody else want to make some comments? Okay, and on the phone, anything anybody wants to say about the finances?
No, I don't think so.
No, okay, thank you. So I will just kind of highlight the looking forwards paragraph then. So looking forward to 2021, our general fund anticipates a deficit of around £15,000 in 2021. If we can maintain levels of planned giving, this will go a long way to meeting this, but there have already been some reductions due to people dying or moving away, so we still need to increase income substantially, and we will be thinking about stewardship again in June.
then there's some stuff there about capital expenditure, which I'm less concerned about, I suppose. It's more the kind of day-to-day money. So we are anticipating a deficit again. The outturn, the financial outturn on this year was actually positive because our income, although it was down, wasn't hit as badly as some, and our expenditure was also down. So our expenditure dropped more than our income fell, which meant that we had a net kind of surplus, a small surplus on this year, because we did less stuff, basically. When our levels of activity return to the levels that they were in 2019, then we will be anticipating a £15,000 deficit. Okay. Any more on finance? No? Okay. Thank you. We also need to receive the annual fabric report. And again, that's in the annual report. If you look around you, you can see the fabric work that was done last summer. So all of this plaster came off last summer. Although that's the most visible thing, I guess, most of the money was spent on the outside of the building doing the repointing work. It's in a way, it's quite nice to have the plaster off because it looks like we got something for our money. Because if we'd spent all that money on the outside and nobody noticed any different, we might feel a little bit swindled. I may as well update you on the plastering now whilst we're all here talking about it. The plaster was removed because it was the wrong type of plaster, so it was a plaster with quite a lot of gypsum in it, which is not the stuff for ancient buildings. It needs to be lime plaster. The problem with the gypsum plaster is that it doesn't allow the water to breathe. It's a stone wall that would naturally have water absorbed into it during the winter, and then it would naturally dry out again over the summer. The problem is that because of the gypsum plaster, that drying out over the summer wasn't happening. So gradually the plaster was beginning to fail and fall off, and we were getting these kind of ugly damp patches and things. So it needed rectifying. So the inappropriate plaster has come off. The walls are now drying out before we can put the lime plaster back on. We are anticipating that that will be an activity for 2022, and that is likely to result in a 6 to 8 week closure of the church building whilst that work goes on. We don't have a time for that yet, so I'm just telling you so that you can get your heads around the fact that we might be turfed out, well, we will be turfed out at some point in 2022 whilst that work happens. Okay. Right. Any comments on the fabric? Yes. Don't know yet, Keith. Not thought about that yet. But yeah, we'll have to go somewhere. Yeah, we will. Not thought it through yet. It might depend on what spaces are available that would fit us at the time. But because that's kind of a year and a half away, or a year away or something, we'll cross that bridge when we come to it. Okay, if there are no other comments on the fabric, I'm sorry, choir, I am aware that you're sitting behind me, so you will have to shout if you, yeah. Then we'll move on. We have to receive a report on the proceedings of the Swindon Deanery Synod. Now, this is in the report on church life. However, the heading is... Oh, mine is correct. Has she changed it? Okay, in some copies of this report, the Deanery Synod heading and the Diocesan Synod heading have been transposed, but in the copy I'm looking at now, it's perfectly fine. Okay, we have to receive it. Are we happy?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you, Veronica. Happy on the phone so far?
Yes.
Delighted. Okay. Now we come to item six, which is the election of three parochial representatives of the laity to the parochial church council for 3 years and two for 1 year. So a full term of PCC membership is 3 years. And so we have three vacancies for 3 years. That's due to members retiring. We also have two vacancies for 1 year. So those are casual vacancies where people have stepped down partway through a term. So we will fill the full vacancies for the full term first, and then if there are other people who would like to stand for the PCC, then we'll fill the casual vacancies. So for the three positions, the three vacancies for 3 years, for a full term, I have three nominations. I have Helena Thomas, Tim Winter, and Lynn Heslett, and they've all been duly nominated and seconded and all the rest of it. They are three people for three vacancies. They are unopposed, so they are duly elected. So thank you very much. Thank you, Tim. Thank you, Lynn. And no interest in the casual vacancies, I take it. Okay, so those casual vacancies will remain open. Great, this is probably a good opportunity to pray for our PCC, so let's pray. We thank you, Lord, for the business of our PCC. We thank you for their diligence, for the care. We ask that you would help them as they manage the business of this church to manage it well, and that you would lead and guide us collectively to a vision for what you might have in store for our parish and our good. Okay, so we're on to item 7, which is to confirm the ex officio member of the parochial church council of Mark Tubey Lewis as lay ministers. So last year, a matter of a couple of weeks, I think, we so that's done. Item 8, we need to deputy church and fills that role as he has ably done. Yes. We need to, and that's the person who's not doing anything naughty business of the church from financial.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Any other comments or questions? Okay. Oh, yeah, Michael. Yeah.
Express our thanks to you, Phil. I wasn't quite sure if there'd be a gap after your closing remarks, so therefore doing it now. But we do appreciate your leadership, indeed your prayerful leadership, at what has been a very challenging year. I think Mark referred to a complicated year. It certainly hasn't been easy. We started off with a service, or when I say we started off, we go back to when we had a 10 o'clock service. Now, in fact, we run three services, in effect, one here, one live streamed, and one on the telephone. And Phil, all the time, you've obviously had to adapt, and we do appreciate what you have done while these things have been happening during the past year. We know that it won't be the same in future. We've all got to look to move forward, but on behalf of everybody, I would just like to thank you for your leadership during this time.
Thank you very much. Thank you. You haven't heard my concluding remarks yet. Okay. Anybody else want to say anything before we move on to concluding remarks? Okay. Right. We'll move on then to concluding remarks. So we do all recognise, I think, that COVID-19 made 2020 a bit of a challenging year. And it's true, I think, for all of us that pretty much every area of our lives was affected by this, and our church life was no exception. I think, generally speaking, our church has weathered the storm well. Our worshipping community is much the same as it was in 2019, and most people have chosen to engage with worship in some form or other, be it on the phone or here in person when the building's been open, or on YouTube. And we've also offered opportunities for people who want to take them to grow as Christian disciples. So we've had groups meeting on Zoom. We've had our Lent course. We've provided opportunities for people to pray together. It's also been really heartening and encouraging that people, members of our church, have taken care of each other. So you'll appreciate that I can't get round and phone everybody, but I am aware that pretty much everybody is being picked up by somebody. And so thank you very much for all of the care that you've taken, both practical, you know, getting things for people who can't get out, phone calls, and prayer support as well. So thank you very much for that. So whilst we have managed to maintain our regular pattern of worship, that's not been the case for all churches, and this year it's been with great sadness that we heard about the closure of Wroughton Methodist Church, and I'm pleased that we're able to welcome Ida this morning, but I'd just like to record that that's a matter, I think, of, well, for me, personal sadness that our brothers and sisters have got to the stage where they are no longer able to meet. As we look forwards into the second half of 2021 and into 2022 and beyond, we can each begin to think about a future where COVID restrictions are largely a thing of the past. So we can think about a new future. But as we do so as a church, I think we need to face up to an old challenge. If you have a look in our annual report, you'll see that there is a paragraph there that talks about the demographics of our congregation, and you'll see that 38% of our congregation is over 70, and 7% are under the age of 18. If you look at the census data, I know we've just had a census, so this is a 10-year-old census data, but if you look at the census data for Wroughton, you'll see that 21% of our population in Wroughton are over 65. So compare that with 38% over 70 in Church, and 21% of our population, coincidentally, are under 18. So one in five people who live around here are under the age of 18, and we have under one in 10. It's clear, because the figures tell us, that we are not successfully passing on our faith to the younger generation. And we haven't been for a number of years. As Christians, we're called, we're commissioned by Christ to go and make new disciples. If my faith is something that has been good for me, if it has changed my life, if it has made my life better than it might otherwise have been, why would I not want to answer Jesus's call to make disciples? Why would I not want to share it if it's the best thing that's happened to me? And it is. Because we are who we are, and we are the ages that we are, reaching out to younger generations is no longer something that we can leave to people who are themselves young. We are the workforce, all of us collectively. We all have to pay our part in two ways, both prayer and action, the two together. So my concluding remark really is a question. What would our church be like? What decisions would we make? How would we be together if engaging with younger generations of Christians was truly a priority for us? If passing on our faith to the next generation is truly a priority for us, what would this community be like? How would we be? What kinds of things will we do or say? Let's stand for the blessing. I hope that what I've just said is received more as a challenge than as a negative, because our Christian faith is about hope. It's about the possibility of new things. It's about the possibility of something better. And so our blessing. May Christ, who out of defeat brings new hope and a new future, fill you with his new life. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.
With the power that raised Jesus from the dead at work within you, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. In the name of Christ, Amen. Alleluia. Alleluia. Alleluia.